telling me now that we're not gonna be able to turn left out of Camorra Truck.
They're gonna put the median there, you think?
The initial plan showed the median would be there, that you could go left or right. And median's there, if it's broken, you could go left or right.
Right. Well, I'm hopeful that they'll at least, you know, put the turn lanes in and maybe put a light there. I don't know that it'll warrant one.
If Charles Lighton's house was still up there, we could get one. He got one over there on the truck route.
I mean, it is a county road. At least it's not a state road. It doesn't be dictated. But
I'm still trying to figure out the median. 41 runs south of here. I don't know if Chattanooga is that one.
No, not anymore these days. They're putting them everywhere.
Okay.
Give me money to take. That's why you have the education. Where did you attend school? Did you go to the University of Georgia?
Georgia State.
Georgia State.
Yes.
Some of the semester that helped you stay for a professor, didn't it?
Totally.
Oh, we did? Okay.
To get my kid out of the house, or
got it figured out, Don?
Yes, sir.
It's gonna be where you can't get there from here.
That's right.
Yeah, thanks.
We're in Sylvia.
Sylvia.
You know, Sylvia Seldon's not ready.
Really?
Dawsonville, and her Deborah Buffalo.
They're trying to sell the house.
She's home with Gerald.
You mean you can't get extra nasty deal?
Well, they pray not.
Until she's not little anymore. Took it out of the station before it came. She's wanted to all be there. They give them their kids. Everything going your way. We'll see.
Instigate.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I
say.
Where's Davey?
I barely miss getting T-boned.
Well, somebody else had a wreck right there in David's yard, you know.
Mm-hmm. That was right on my T-bone.
Oh, Leland had to go up through Olin's yard.
Should I have?
Yeah, I just caught him.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Well, this is not a legitimate public meeting. To be quite honest with you, we had a zoning come up. It wasn't even a zoning, it was a sketch plat. And on the sketch plat hearing, it was about a piece of property that was zoned in the early 2000s or mid-2000s. I'm not looking at my paperwork. But we rescheduled that meeting to November 7th so we'd have time to get their conditions, which they'd like to see in the paperwork done. In the meantime, it seems like the Committee for the Traffic Fix sent out an email to everybody. Fix the traffic tonight. Oh, they didn't tell me they were going to do that. Nor did they think about it, but everybody's welcome anyways. What I'm getting at is we need to respectfully take care of the first meeting first, since it was actually their meeting. And Greg, you here? There's Greg. You can ask him how that happened. I don't know. I guess he sent the email for everybody to be here for the fix the traffic stuff. But we'll touch on that too. But if you just respectfully, if you'll let the meeting that I set up, if we can take care of them first, please. And then we'd be happy to get to any questions y'all have. The folks on the Ryland Group, well, it was Ryland at one time. Y'all want to step, I guess, in the other room? We'll just hand write out conditions. Anybody here for the Mullinax 32 lots?
I think it's tied together.
Yeah, is it all tied together?
I think
okay.
It's kind of all.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay. If you don't mind, y'all, to get to this as respectfully as possible, to get this, let's let the people live the closest to the property that are most concerned about what happens right next to them put in conditions, because it really, they have to live there. And let's be respectful to them for that. Then if there's any outside of that, everybody's allowed to speak to it. For those of you who don't understand how that came about, most everything that you see today that is putting cars on the road today was zoned from year 2000 through, I believe, 2009. Nothing that I can recall that I've zoned has placed a car on the road yet. Anything that I've been involved in any zoning since 2011 could be sitting or in the process of developing it now or building the houses now. A lot of these lots that you see in land sitting that you think is just farmland could have been zoned all this time, and they're just coming alive with the economy. So a lot of them are zoned that I wasn't even aware of zoned, because there's no way I could keep up with everything that goes on in the county. It's very, very difficult until they come up in front of you. Anyways, that being said, you know why we probably have all this traffic. Now, yesterday in the meeting, we touched on whether or not it'd be smart to do zonings, one per district, trying to disperse around the county. I can tell you one commissioner got extremely loud with me, as all, I don't know if you want to see in my face, but it was very rude. They didn't want to hear any of it, basically the majority of the board. So that being said, the best you can do is have planning for the future. I said, we need to get with the state DOT, the state representatives, which is set up for October 30th this month, in a traffic summit, which I'll be in. Hopefully they will start bringing dollars and cents to our county to keep up with our growth. Being that all of these zonings were done in the 2000s, there's been plenty of time for them to understand what's coming forward, that and the schools, and to make proper planning, I told them. They probably don't like me a lot for those comments, but it is what it is. So anyways, the school board told me they're gonna get me in the next week or two their plans where they own lots, land, and what they plan on doing. They only have one elementary school that's somewhat set in stone to come forward. They were explaining to me that they don't do anything until they actually see the residents in the homes and the crowds are already there. That's the way they do it, they said. So anyways, I'm hoping that we can get some funding for more schools, get those going. Keep in mind, those are all state. Schools are not county. It says Forsyth County. State of Georgia runs them, not us. We have no say-so. On your tax bill, it's collected under the county tax bill. Law says the county has to collect it for the state school systems, and we give it to them. That's how that works. We don't have any say-so in how they operate them, what they do, what they bond, anything. We just hope they pay attention and build for the future, and the state the same. Anybody here, if you look down Post Road, you'll see different intersection improvements. That's a state road. Once again, state has not stepped up, in my opinion, and fulfilled their obligation. The county has. That's our dollars, your tax dollars, paid for all those intersections on state roads. Unfortunately, that leaves us short of money for our county roads. It makes it double hard on us. So if you, any of y'all got my email back that asked you to contact the state representatives and let them know, hey, please step up, fulfill your obligations so we're not having to pay for your roads and our roads. In my opinion, a state road is a primary road. They should be four lane first. If there's still a need to do our back roads or secondary roads, then so be it. But they shouldn't be the first ones out of the chute becoming a four lane. You may agree or disagree with me on this. If Highway 9 was done 10, 15 years ago in a four lane, and the people went down Highway 9 without any resistance from traffic and went to McFarland to get to 400, where they'd be screaming and yelling, our secondary road Mullinax needs to be paved to a four-lane highway. It's the same thing with Castleberry Road and other secondary roads. If Highway 9 was built all the way up, four-lane into the city of Cumming, would people be wanting to make Castleberry Road a four-lane road and runs parallel with it? I don't think so, personally. That's just where I stand on it. I mean, y'all's welcome to tell me your opinion as well too, but if the folks on this zoning, I'm just looking for to make sure we have conditions that you would like to see in the sketch plat. And I've had some talks with folks. I reset that for the main purpose of, and I saw there's still controversy of not believing what he said, she said basically was going on. There was no way I was going to be able to hear all the conversations, correctly make my notes, get a motion made that would have got them the conditions they were looking for, and I was afraid I was going to get something wrong, and once it's voted on, it's there, it's done. So prudently, I reset it to make sure we get this right for you all that are interested in getting this right. And if some folks were afraid I was doing something behind the scenes, and I wonder if that's not the case. I did ask the representative, the attorney, to be here, because he's going to also take notes. We're all going to compare notes, and when they go up on the screen, if it goes that far, then we want to make sure they're exactly what we said we wanted in there. That set aside, at some point, they also have the ability to say, okay, we withdraw our application. We can't handle all your requests. Sorry. We're going to go back to what's already zoned. And they have that right, too. So just keep that in mind. And Mr. Scoggins, if you don't mind, everything that you had up on the screen the other day, we are also looking, or they are asked if we could put some square foot minimums in on the houses as well.
Yes.
To make sure we have a product that brings a reasonable dollar up to me and keeps the quality of the community up.
Sure.
On the 10-1 conditions that they put in, they indicated they would, the houses would have no less than 2,800 square feet, heated floor space exclusive of garages, and also that the homes would have a minimum two-car garage. And that still is.
Okay. Right.
That's a pretty reasonable size. We see a lot of times minimum square feet, that's 28. They will have somebody come in and ask for something bigger. It's typically, you know, it's just your minimum, obviously. And I'm assuming that's on two stories, because there's no way you'll put a 2,800 square foot ranch in a home that size.
Can we ask if there's any possibility that Ryland would consider higher priced homes on larger lots so that we set the right tone on Mullinax rather than starting in the 283s or whatever it was that was mentioned? Is there any willingness to go back and at least look at that possibility?
Sure, we can certainly go back. My name is Josh Scoggins, by the way. I represent Ryland. We can certainly go back and look at that. I think we did agree to a condition on the exterior finishes and on the sizes, and that's really going to, I think, drive the market price. We can't dictate a specific market price, but of course we can look at exteriors and that sort of thing.
So in there, as you all see in the new designs today, may have a percentage of brick stone, and they may have certain other facade designs like shake shingles, or of course symmetric shake shingles nowadays, mostly for fire. A lot of people would rather do that. Yes, sir.
I was going to say, just to, I guess, clarify or come back on what Mr. Scoggins was saying, is, yeah, we can't dictate a sales price, but we know a 2,800 square foot house, which the vast majority of them are going to be 2,800 square feet exactly, maybe 2,850. They're going to go in exactly at that minimum, and with that front facade, we know what they're going to bring.
What do you think a 2,800 square foot home brings with a good decent facade on it?
High twos. I mean, you look around what's selling in the county right around here. That's what's selling. So if we were to say, okay, let's go with 3,200 foot minimum, now we're going to get up in probably closer to four. My standpoint on that is, instead of in this part of the county where we are, instead of trying to cram as many houses on, you know, going for a 7 or 9 or 11,000 square foot lot, how about doing a 15,000 square foot lot, 17,000 square foot lot, put a bigger house on there, charge more money, you're going to help in the, you're going to get less resistance from the community, you're going to get less traffic, and your profit's probably still going to be the same. And I know Ryland builds in that scope. They build in that price range all day long. So that's what I personally would like to see. In this part of the county, they can get that. They can get $500,000 all day long. I know Greg has examples of what they're getting farther up post. They're getting spec homes?
$650,000.
And they're selling them before they're built. That's what I would like to see.
How will we find out from you, Josh, what Ryland's response to this is? Will they come out with another, will you email us?
Sure.
Or will they come out with another, if they agree, another sketch plat showing?
Well, the sketch plat doesn't show the homes. So,
well, but right. If the lots were, like as Rob said, a little bit bigger and so forth, how would we know whether they've agreed to that or not?
Sure, I'll talk with Ryland tomorrow and email you. I don't have everybody's email. I think I have yours, Rob, but if you could disseminate the email.
Anybody's email address that I don't have, come and see me after the email edges the list.
We know that we're very limited on, I would think I speak with as a group, but we know we're very limited on what we can do with this one, where this Wendy Hill Mullinax. It's already zoned. There's a few other pieces that are already zoned. We're limited. Ryland really likes our county, as noted by the number of applications they have currently pending and what they've already been doing. I think if we could agree on find a happy medium, we're not going to stop development, but we don't want this small track home feel in our community. So if we could come to an agreement where future developments, future zoning applications would kind of try to adhere to this a true R3, 15,000 square foot lot, larger homes, I would think that we could probably agree as a community that we will give Ryland much less of a hard time on future developments. And Mr. Levent as well, we probably wouldn't flood his
It's from events like the rag doll, and I'm welcome to be the rag doll.
Right, but when we see things like the one going up on, across from the doctor, two lots in there, 7,000 square feet, there's no place.
Well, there's a zoning application. Mr. Levent said something changed with that, but that there were 150 apartments originally was my understanding of what I read online, and then another subdivision for 90. So when you add all of those, plus what's going on down Post Road, and then Ryland, we're not trying to put the whole burden on Ryland, but we've got to find a way to manage that traffic until we can get something done. And what Rob is suggesting is one of those ways.
Sure, and to your point, you know, and to your point, Rob, Ryland didn't zone this property.
I understand that.
And, you know, it was zoned, it's been there for a while, Ryland acquired it. We're trying to do the best we can, sort of with the hand we've been dealt. I know that one of the big concerns, probably from you, Beth, was about the hill.
When residents,
and there's been some
people are going to come out on Mullinax and Wendy Hill, and Wendy Hill is not meant, it can't take the traffic, and Mullinax is already backed up every single day past Sterling Pond and sometimes further in the morning.
The worst part of that, we're pulling out blind. That hill, you cannot see anything coming. One of us is going to get killed coming out of Wendy Hill.
Well, it's not just pulling out, it's also trying to turn onto Wendy Hill.
And coming in.
Yeah, this is something that we've had multiple, I've had multiple discussions with the engineering, the director of engineering. We are absolutely trying to get that done with this neighborhood. I know we're going to get some pushback from them because it's a very small neighborhood. The bigger neighbors they are, the more money they make, the more they can afford to do these things for us. But we are absolutely hoping that this does come within this sketch plan. Approval should it be approved.
And I have talked to Ryland. I talked to them this afternoon. Our original sketch plan request was for 32 lots. Res 3. Again, as Commissioner Levent said, it is a numbers game. Taking that hill down to what the engineering department would want it to be, I don't know what it costs. I think Ryland's engineers have looked at it. If we can reach an agreement tonight on the 32-lot plan, Ryland has assured me that 32 lots will be enough to pay for lowering that hill.
And obviously, I was trying to lower it. Kind of pushed them down to 30, but this is a give and take thing.
Right, and to Commissioner Levent's point, he's exactly right. We agreed to cut the number of lots from 32 to 30, and at that number, speaking with Eric Masashi with Ryland, he said we don't have a final number on that hill because that hill's going to have to come down at least 10 feet.
But if we were originally zoned, and we keep mentioning this, this was originally zoned, and the possibility of going back to that original zoning. How can you go back to an original zoning when 5.75 acres on the other side of Mullinax Road has been taken away from the original zoning? And you had a total of 35 houses going in on almost 19 acres versus 30 to 32 on 14 acres.
Well, to answer your question, when that property was zoned, you're right. There was a 14 acre tract that we're talking about. There was a 6 acre, 5.5 acre tract across the street. There was actually no limit imposed on the number of lots.
In the zoning.
In the zoning.
This is complicated.
And let me try to explain that. Whenever you submit a concept plan, that plan is subject to change, such as number of lots may be less. Typically, the way the commissioners ensure that no more lots are built is a zoning condition is in place. Well, this was zoned years and years ago. There was no such condition put on it. So technically speaking, anybody could come in and fit as many lots as they could physically put under the code on that property. It is not limited currently. Just because the concept plan said 35 does not mean that it has to be limited to 35 lots. There were 28, you're right, shown on this particular piece of property. Ryland is proposing 32 with bigger lots on average than the ones that were approved the first time. And also, like I said,
if they can get the 32 lots, I think that they've told me that the numbers work out to where they can take that hill down, because I can assure you that's not going to be an inexpensive endeavor to grade that hill all the way back down to grade.
It's the director of planning development has a little bit different opinion. However, this, if it hatches out of court, will be ultimately up to the judge's decision, whether or not it's 28, 32. But he is correct about they did not put a cap of lots on there. Now we do. Because of this.
Sir? What was the minimum lot square footage at the time that this was zoned versus what it is now?
9,000, and it's still 9,000 yeah. today.
If you drop your request for variances, setback, side setback?
We have, and let me answer that in two parts. First, there were four variances approved with the zoning. Those variances are still on the property as far as we're concerned. One of those was to reduce the distance between homes. We asked for that again on the sketch plat, but we've agreed to withdraw that variance and not adhere to any of the variances that were approved the first time, even though they could.
That was my asking, obviously.
And Commissioner Levin asked us to get rid of
that. Does that give us a benefit, or does that give Ryland a benefit? Because if you don't have that variance, you don't have to go in and put firewalls all the way around those homes anymore. So you've just decreased your costs on the home.
No, actually I believe that wouldn't really make an impact at 15 feet. They have to offset windows and doors and that sort of thing, but using any type of masonry siding or brick, that's not going to be implicated. We've withdrawn that variance because they feel as though they can fit the homes in there. It may be a little tighter, but we can keep the walls 20 feet apart.
For me and for a lot of other people, you have an issue of impervious surfaces. And with the big creek basin that we're in, it's pretty darn important. And I don't like to give a blanket variance of a few hardships here and there, or here and there, but I just assume them all be 20 feet apart, not only for fire, but also for your impervious surface ratings.
And again, that's something that's actually entitled right now, but we've agreed to not pursue it.
In other words, if we
the home, you wouldn't need 32 lots like you're talking.
I'm sorry, say that again.
If you increase the prices of the homes that you're putting on those lots, you wouldn't need as many lots.
That's what I was going to point out is like, isn't that a wash, or just explain that to us, is why do those last two homes enable you guys to make $100,000 or whatever it's going to cost to change that road,
candidly,
as opposed to going 30?
Candidly, I don't underwrite Ryland's projects, and so I don't know what.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's like you're trying to sell to us as a benefit, like let us do 32.
I'm just telling you what
we'll,
I was.
I know. I'm not blaming you. I'm just saying, you know, you're trying to sell us on 32 so that you can afford to do that. Well, we're trying to sell you guys on 25
yeah.
with a $75,000, $100,000 higher price tag.
But go ahead.
Yeah, I won't be able to answer you exactly because I don't know their business plan.
Right.
But I do ask, I'd like to know what the market's bringing, so I kind of understand it myself. And I'm understanding in the south part of the county, they're selling these lots, I guess once they develop them back, they're building them back into the houses or selling them off to the builders, and the rate's between $60,000 and $90,000 per lot. Mm-hmm. So I guess if they're saying they've got two extra lots, they could have possibly $120,000 to $180,000 difference to play with. I don't know that's true, but this is what I'm understanding the market is bringing in. But whatever y'all tell us to do tonight, I'm going to go with it. If they can't live with it, that's going to be something they have to deal with. And if they choose to pull back the application and stick with what's there now, they're going to hatch it out with the director. The director of planning and zoning believes that it's not 30 or 32. He believes it's more, maybe 25 to 28. They believe it's different. We'll probably be in court over what they're telling me. I don't care. I'm just saying, if you can come up with an agreement tonight, you might get conditions that you won't have otherwise if it goes to court, because it will definitely bounce back to what is zoned if we don't approve their sketch plan with additional conditions and agreements that they may accept or not accept. We'll see.
Well, I think some of it, us being able to agree comes somewhat on their answer as to whether they're willing to consider increasing the price of the homes that they're building. You know, 30, even 30 lots at what range did you suggest, Rob?
Those houses are selling all day long for under three.
Why don't we see if they'll live with increasing the size of the lot first to 10,000 or so? Then we'll bump up the square footage because it has to fit on the lot.
Sure.
Or maybe you ask them to go to 11,000 and bump them to 3,000 square foot lots. And just, this is why I wanted to have this meeting as early as we are, because November 7th is a little bit away still. It's going to have to bounce back and forth. But I need to know from you all truly what you want, how far they'll let us go and put conditions in before they say, okay, we can't go anymore.
Well, we keep discussing conditions. Mm-hmm. Okay?
There's no.
We have a very big deal with conditions, because one of the conditions mm-hmm. that was listed in those 13 there was that there won't be an entrance to Mullinax Road. From the community participation meeting, there was never an entrance planned to Mullinax Road. That is not a condition.
But again, that goes back, and I want to be clear about this, it goes back to the concept plan. It is not at all uncommon in zoning cases, development cases, for a road to be proposed in one place and then moved somewhere else. The condition, this is exactly what happened on the original zoning. There was no limit on the number of lots. There was no limit on the entrances, things like that. And so when you get to the sketch plat process, the board's discretion becomes much more limited. This is more of a check the box kind of scenario. It's not a zoning. There's no way factor here. There are six criteria. Do you have water? Do you have sewer? Things like that that go into a sketch plat. And so when we put a condition on it that says no entrance on the Mullinax Road, that protects you in the future in case somebody else comes and wants to change that, they have to go back to the commissioners for a hearing.
But if Ryland is indeed giving 85 feet of road frontage all the way down the property line, and that belongs to Forsyth County, how can anybody else go in there and put a road in it, Josh?
Because again, timing issue with development. The right-of-way is deeded at the time of final plat. So if right, and that means it's almost built. That's okay. Where your lots are on the ground, you're going in for your houses, that kind of thing. That's when the right-of-way is typically given. So just, for instance, there was a condition on the original zoning that said you shall dedicate the right-of-way for Mullinax. That hasn't been done yet because the development didn't occur. But it will at the time of final plat. So again,
I guess we're talking about emails in reference to what we're discussing at this point.
Yeah, but I mean, if it doesn't hurt you to have that in there, does it? It protects you?
But this bending over backwards stuff about conditions that don't make a hill of beans about anything is just crazy.
But do you want it in there?
Huh?
Do you want that in there, number
what,
eight?
What, no entrance to Mullinax?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, okay. But the thing I'm saying is we're making it like, oh my God, look at how much we've given you to be able to put these homes next to where you live. When in essence, and one of the questions that I proposed to you when we were sitting over at Wendy's just a few moments ago, if the county owns from the yellow line of the road 60 feet the right of way, and you said they're obtaining that, so if you're obtaining it, how are they donating it to you?
Well, it's a final plat.
Okay, but if the county's obtaining it, my question again is, if the county's obtaining it, how is Ryland donating it? If it's 60 feet from the yellow line to the other side of the road on a county road, in both directions, then in essence, they're giving you 25 feet versus 85. That's what I'm saying. All these conditions about we're donating this and the entrance is not going there and this is not gonna happen there, they're not indeed conditions. They're verbiage.
Okay, we'll call it verbiage.
Right?
The bottom line is, the truth is, let's say they get the sketch plan approved and y'all come up with an agreement. And let's say they try and decide to sell somebody else for some weird reason. You're going to want that in there to hold the new guy to the same thing where they can't put on Mullinax. That's why you want it in there. Now, the county right now is acquiring right-of-way or attempting to acquire right-of-way down Mullinax now. They deed this to us and they give it to us at no cost at final plat. We at least don't have to spend money on that. You have more money towards your road in the future. It's less tax dollars have to be spent. I know it's not a lot, but it's all adds up eventually. But we're wasting our time on something that's in there that you need to leave in there anyways. Let's talk about other things that you absolutely want to see in there.
I got it. And I think, and if you disagree with me, you can raise your hand. I don't think 32 homes works.
We went from 32 to 30, back down to 28, back down to the possibility of 25 in the Board of Commissioners meetings, and now all of a sudden, we'll take your hill out if you'll let us increase our homes back from 28 to 32 again.
Well, just to be clear, Ryland never agreed to go to 28. I was authorized to agree to 30. When the hill issue came up, and they started looking at it to see what it would cost, and I don't know what it would cost, I was told, look, all this stuff costs money. On a 32-lot subdivision, I can't imagine that the profit margin is, I mean, it's not like it's Fieldstone or something like that where you're going to be in there for 20 years. Taking that hill down, I'll get a cost on it, but from what I understand, it's quite extensive. And when you're dealing with a company, a home builder, if it doesn't make money or make financial sense, they're not going to do it.
Can I ask you a question?
With all due respect, I don't care if Robin makes any money or not. Somebody in our neighborhood is going to get killed at that intersection.
And listen,
you've got 50 people who know to blame if one of us gets hurt or killed.
Yeah. And so you're don't saying think our life
I would hesitate
is not worth
to do
it.
That.
And
we, wait a minute.
We don't live in Fieldstone either. I live on Windy Hill Court.
I've been involved in accidents.
I never said that people's lives didn't mean anything. What I'm telling you is Ryland is offering to cut the hill down. They're not obligated to do that right now. We're trying to do what we can to make it as safe as we can. We're not putting roads on the Mullinax. We're trying to do these things to make it better for everyone. It's not as though we're trying to
make money.
We all make money. They earn
you don't
the
care about who gets killed.
That's right. When my kid gets hit.
Do you honestly believe that I wouldn't care if somebody
got killed?
I've
already been involved in an accident at that intersection. I've already been hit at that intersection. I know what I'm talking about.
Okay.
Somebody's kid, inexperienced driver, is going to get T-boned there and probably killed. So y'all can have two more lots.
I just got hit the other day, turn it into Windy Hill Road. Car come over that, SUV come over that hill so fast you could see they had their car lurch forward just because they had to put on their brakes.
Can you do, if we said we won't argue with 30 homes again, that's still more than what the planning and development director indicates he believes. You believe there isn't a limit or it's 30 to 32. If we said 30, and again, you increased the prices of the homes, the profit margin would be there for you to go ahead and cut that hill down, don't you?
I'll certainly talk to Riley.
I mean, that would take care of what they need. It would take care of our concerns about lower valued homes.
And it also show they actually care about the community a little bit.
Well, we know they're there for business. There's no personally.
They can give back.
Yes, they can.
Money, they can give back.
Yeah, that's right.
Ryland can save some money. They don't have to lower the hill. That ain't gonna slow the traffic down.
No, it's gonna speed it up.
That three-way stop sign.
We certainly could. We could certainly try.
But we've to put up four signs for a stop sign.
And I'm not saying listen, they probably wouldn't listen to us anymore.
That's the county that's not listening to you. So we need to press on them as well as asking for more.
I asked the director about this three-way stop. And it's the same thing I get any time I ask for something like that. It's not warranted. But the truth of the matter is, I agree with them. It just means what he always tells me.
One car will kill somebody.
That's correct.
It don't matter if it takes 100 cars.
Here's what normally happens in these stages. We get the intersection fixed. Then we come back and let them do their study and try to twist that arm to get it in. Happens all the time. We get traffic lights eventually that way. We get stop signs eventually that way. Mm-hmm. I don't have the authority as a commissioner to just tell them what to do, unfortunately. I don't. They're supposed to have the engineering degree for the traffic. I don't. However, I can absolutely reiterate what the public is saying and have them at least go out there
or
do a traffic count, do a study.
Stop sign at 5 o'clock in the afternoon.
I totally believe you.
What we're saying.
But we would give you, Commissioner Levent, Josh, and anybody from Ryland a personal invitation to come and set up the stop sign at Windy Hill Court and try to get back in. There was someone from the county.
The director of engineering.
Well, there was someone from the county yesterday.
Are you
right? That was at the meeting.
For a three-way
hey,
stop.
Believe me.
Camorra Trail.
I get it. I agree with you.
For 20 to 25
I want to read what the county's saying. Everybody says they can't and they don't want to. I want to read what the county's saying. I have
well,
to know what they're saying.
That may be something in your file.
Read it.
And then I hear about it later.
This is an email from Tim Allen to John Kennard. John, we already have advanced intersection signs on Windy Hill Drive with a 20 mile an hour speed limit advisory plates on both that approach the Windy Oak Drive. Windy Hill Court should be. The sight distance from Windy Hill Court looking west is plus 400 feet, correct. Probably maybe a little more, a little less, okay? Looking east, it is around 130 feet. That is not correct. You have a stop sign and a hill. Until they crest that hill, you can't see them coming from Mullinax Road.
And they okay? are rolling
they come
down that road.
Yeah,
they're not going in 35.
They do 35 down that road. 65 to 75.
Look, I'll make a pledge to y'all. I will call John Kennard in the morning to make him commit Thursday or Friday to go down there and meet with me.
I mean, we play roulette every time.
And don't come 2 o'clock. Come during the morning traffic, the lunch traffic, or the evening traffic.
Yes, ma'am.
You want
them parked out. I'll be them down there.
They won't do that. That makes too much sense.
For the car
cab. Hey, have John meet you at 8 o'clock in the morning.
Make sure
he comes out Highway 9.
There's some
more. Yes.
Hey, Mullinax. Yes. Hey, Mullinax. Might want to leave the 7 to get there on time.
Right.
I get it. I drive these roads too, guys. I live right here with y'all. I get it. Although I don't see this hill because I don't do, but I've been on all these roads in the traffic hour and I've sat in it too. I feel your pain. I do.
Yeah.
And the worst one, I couldn't believe the other day was coming back on McFarland trying to turn right back on Union Hill.
Oh, that's
but back up in the dirt. You sit there in the holes and the ruts. It was crazy. I get it. We talked about all of that in the meeting yesterday and we're trying to fast track that and we're going to bring us a report back for funding that they can find to start getting that fixed. At least those two intersections now, as quick as possible, since the Mullinax is several years down the road.
That intersection is also the school bus stop.
Right. Yeah.
We have our kids that are coming up, and I mean, our kids, they drive, so every time they leave, they roll the dice.
And that's the worst part of it. That's what I'm
scared
of.
I promise you, I will call him whenever.
They come over that hill doing 50, and the kid's standing there waiting for the bus.
Well, I mean, that's their petition, because they come over that hill. They're going to be coming out there. Subdivision right there, I mean.
But they're not going to set up that stop sign and wait 30 minutes to get in the road. I can grant you that.
No,
right
yeah.
Now.
Yeah.
Hey, Todd, what's the county's take or the county's view on, yeah, I think the bigger issue, kind of what a lot of us here for, in addition to the safety of Windy Hill Court, but when you look at the traffic right there, I mean, it's not uncommon to take an hour to go 2 miles to get from where it backs up on Mullinax to get through there. And then you still, I mentioned it in the meeting of last week, is even once you get out on McFarland, 400 is so jammed that it can take you 20 minutes. Once you turn on McFarland, it can take 20 minutes just to get on 400. And not considering what you're gonna hit farther down. So what is the county, when the zoning applications come in, granted the ones that are already approved are approved, not much done, okay? So all the new applications come in, what's the county's take on trying to mitigate the increased traffic and maintaining the quality of life? Like, what are they thinking?
Well, I tried to bring it up yesterday in a meeting. Jim Boff started with a harsher approach of a total or one. He wanted to do some moratoriums and some sharing the load, if you will. And I was all about sharing the load, meaning a zoning per district per month instead of it being an open floodgate, where our third district's getting hammered with 50-60% of the zonings that are coming through are gonna be over here. And man, I got chewed up by the commissioners. It takes three commissioners to vote something through, and I did not have their support. Mm-hmm. However, the meeting, I made my points towards the end of the meeting that if we don't get with the state to find out what their state road plans are for our future, and the school doesn't also do the same thing, and we know, we have got to be more prudent and reasonable with our decisions on zones. And I just wasn't getting traction. So this, what Greg is
helping us put together and bring this to light, it takes all of us to get their attention to get the three votes, unfortunately.
Excuse me. So their objection to questions about too much traffic and lower quality of life, what is their objection to that?
They don't live here.
No, no, I'm not talking about developers. I'm talking about the other commissioners gave it to me. They have, they're large landowners, some of them, or their best friends are large landowners. And they don't, Miss Mills was literally verbally on me pretty harsh yesterday. I had the point I looked at, I said, Miss Mills, please calm down. In our meeting, our open meeting. So I don't.
Who are her friends?
She lives in north part of the county. She's a district court commissioner. She doesn't, I don't know that she understands what the pain that we're feeling here with the traffic. And I will tell you that one of the worst roads in the county is Old Atlanta Road. They've been dealing with, y'all are starting to feel now, for years and years down there. They desperately need road improvements, but those are county roads. So there's two roads we're discussing putting on some fast track. It's Old Atlanta Road and Mullinax right now, because that's where the pain is. But when you're backing up off Highway 400 and it just keeps continuing to back up, the state needs to get involved at some point.
But doesn't the county have some responsibility to say, all right, the state's not on board yet. We got people that already live here.
I agree. That was my point yesterday. It just wasn't being heard very well. I don't know what else to tell you. I'll go back and watch the videos. You'll see where everybody stood on it. I felt like I was a little kid getting hammered verbally.
It wasn't north on 400 in the afternoon. It's as bad as trying to go south at any time.
And here's the sad part about it. If we shut down everything today, there's so much zone from the last 10 to 13 years, it's only going to get worse.
Yeah. Why can't that be re-looked at again?
It can't. The law doesn't allow it. Each and every one, if you have time, go pull up the state constitution under land rights. And you'll start to understand a little bit how the law works. And we're county commissioners. State law trumps us, it dictates to us what we can and can't do. And zonings are actually considered legislative. Once it's done, it's there. The property owner or an applicant on behalf of the property owner, which have to bring the affidavit in, has to petition for it.
How far are we from the total saturation point? No more homes south of Highway 20 in the county?
I'm going to have to rely on Josh a little bit for that, but
I don't know.
I don't know the exact number. A saturation point, boy, you'd have people arguing that to forever, because the one that wants to make the money on owns the land can argue forever more. Oh no, we're nowhere near it. The sewer capacity, we're getting ready to build another plant, so that won't be able to be said. And we finally won the appeals in the court, so that's going to be released pretty soon. Water could be one of the major factors. EPD has not raised the permits for the county and the city. I tried to get ours increased. It didn't happen. And I want to get into all those details. That was pretty ugly, too. But it is what it is. And
there seems to be more open property on Barrett Parkway west off of 575 over to 120 than there is in the south.
When you, here you go. You're going to love it. When you have some of the best schools in the state, and when you've got the lower crime rates, and you've got some of the lower taxes, but you have some of the best services and the best parks to offer, everybody wants to come. And when they get here, they don't want anybody else to come.
Yeah, I just need to
I've been here all my life.
Well, you're the winner. Thanks for letting me in 1990. I appreciate that. But it is how it works. I mean, it really, really is.
With that argument, shoot, why can't they come pay more for the homes? The $300,000-$400,000 range, if they're willing to have that lifestyle and area, they put it in the pocket for it.
Absolutely agree. If you slow down the zoning just a little bit, it would automatically start raising property values also. And those landowners should understand that their land will become more valuable that way as well. It may not be as fast turning at that.
Could you tell me who Bill Powell is, by chance?
Bill was an engineer in the engineering department.
Okay. Here's some more.
1,300 employees. I'm sorry, I don't know all the names.
Well, I don't know everybody.
And
these emails weren't sent directly to me. There's another person that lives on Windy Hill Court who's out of town on business, and he brought these to me to where they could be read here tonight. Now, this is from Bill Power. Back to John again. John, here's the language added.
owner developer shall lower the hill crest at the prospective entrance of Windy Hill Drive as required by the Department of Engineering to provide additional site distance from Windy Hill Court. Bill, and then from Kennard back to Bill. Bill, you can add this as a recommended condition. I understand recommended is recommended, okay? I would recommend that you condition Ryland, and this is to Mr. Levent, I would recommend that you condition Ryland to lower the hill crest at their proposed entrance on Windy Hill Drive as required by the Department of Engineering to provide additional site distance for the Windy Hill Court. Let me know if you are okay with this, and I will have Bill to add it to our technical review. Okay, back to Joe from John again. I got your voicemail and just wanted to let you know that I did let the board know last night that we had recommended a condition, and that's why we presented the petition at the board meeting. We were told that this would be a condition, okay? It was never mentioned, okay? For the board's consideration, that would require the hill crest to be lowered on Windy Hill Drive. We only recommend it, and the decision is up to the board. I will forward you the email where I had the staff to make the recommendation, and I will also forward you the email that I received from Tim Allen after they reviewed the road. Also, just to let you know, I talked with the developer's attorney during break last night and told him that they should look at what would be required to lower the hill and agree to lower it. It is my intent to do what I can to get the developer to do this within my authority. Let me know if you have any additional questions.
That was the same discussion I had with John Kennard within their authority.
Okay.
And this is why I wanted this meeting so bad. We need to hatch this out now. Okay. Tell them where we are and that we absolutely need this. And this is a great thing for Ryland to do.
And you said you were the traffic, and there's other people here in reference to the traffic. What is the possibility of stretching our little rubber cables right across Mullinax Road and Windy Hill Drive as a cut-through road to see what the traffic volume is there? Because John, in these emails, seems to think there's not a problem with the traffic in this area.
I'm going to bring him down there. I may even bring the assistant county manager as well. Because sometimes, commissioners are not managers. We are not bosses of the employees. However, we can ask the county manager, deputy county manager to get involved. They are their bosses. We are not. We're policymakers, we handle budgets, and we do other things, but we're not allowed to micromanage employees. However, there is ways to get them out there to come look at this and realize the reality of it.
I'll advise you when you ask them to come out to tell them exactly where to put the instrument, because we'd ask them on behalf of our little family that we have to do that. We want to get the total gauge at Union Hill and Mullinax. So Tim Allen obliged and said, I'll come out, and he was very friendly about it. And he came back to me and said, there's only 9,500 cars that travel Mullinax Road in a given day.
Oh, no.
I believe...
It was 10,000 10 years ago.
He said, I believe that the road can handle about 14.5. So I believe the road can handle an additional 50% than what it has right now. And I thought about it. I said, it doesn't really make any sense. And I asked him, I said, where did you put the instrument? Did you put the instrument north of Fowler Road, or did you put it south of Fowler Road? And he came back and said, I put it north of Fowler Road. So they completely didn't count anybody coming off of or onto Fowler Road, which is thousands of people. We know that. So we need to make sure that the instruments are placed in the right place and that we ask the right questions when they do that. So
and furthermore, the big picture too on this, Greg and I have sat with Tom Brown when we were asked about traffic, and they said they don't really take traffic into consideration much at all. When it comes to making planning and zoning decisions, it just isn't a big factor. Where Commissioner Levent,
go read that darn thing. It hampers us.
Commissioner Levent may not agree with them, but I don't know. I think my question is how do we get some of these other commissioners who seem to care less about the situation, yet affect our lives, to care about it because it is a significant infrastructure issue. Aside from voting them out, is there any way to?
But we can't vote for them anymore.
But the people in those communities have got to understand morals and ethics and a conscience. Unfortunately, you can't teach. You either have it or you don't. So when you're voting for somebody, try to get to know them, shake their hand, learn who you're really voting for. The best you can, and try to get somebody there that actually cares more about the homeowners and the citizens than they do the big pockets and the developers.
I mean, I know it's hard to get more involved. Sir?
Cindy Miller, who wants to sell the houses that she's approving?
Hey, see, I can't comment on that.
I mean, I got a question, not changing the subject. How about, I mean, say they build their houses in there, 30, 32, 25, whatever. Where's the water going?
That's all done by the engineering department. What the sketch plat they have is not a final plat.
Y'all in the low place, y'all get washed away.
Well, that's not. They have to do retention ponds. They have to control their water. The state laws flow down to the county, and the county has to enforce as our engineer department. They'll literally walk that property when the final plat's
coming. That gentleman right there.
My driveway 3 weeks ago washed out like you took a loader and drove through it, because all the development upstream,
the industrial park,
and they've done nothing to try to control.
Did you call the engineer department?
I've called them out there, and it's not their problem.
What?
That's what they tell. They wouldn't help him fix it, nothing.
So Ryan's home going to be responsible for the water?
Go read the state law in reference to water, controlling your water, not damaging somebody else's property. There are laws in place.
That's right.
The answer is yes.
Try to tell them that you sold her a Walmart.
Yep.
Well, it doesn't mean they're going to step up on the road, unfortunately. I mean, you know, I mean, I can't make them do that, but.
Well, it's funny, you know, nobody can make anybody do anything. So the bad stuff just keeps happening. But everybody gives the same answer.
I'm gonna tell them myself. I had something in my house due to those heavy rains this summer, got damaged too. I'm 4,000 in the hole. Do I blame my neighbor for it now? I don't know. 17 years later, it just happened. I mean, those
but
rains
I'm not
were
even
horrendous.
Talking about the money. I'm talking about safety issues, big time.
Yeah. I'm gonna get out there. I promise you. I'll get them out there this week.
Can you email some of us so that somebody who is very aware of where to place the instrument and so forth is there from the community to be with you all?
I'll tell you what Greg said. They've done it to me. And I have to quit. Now I realize the same thing he realized when I Bentley Road and Post Road, trying to get a count there, because it's another bad left turn when the kids have to go to school. And the cars are running 55 miles an hour there. My son, passenger, was in a wreck last week there. That doesn't change their mind. It's just the way it is. It's unbelievable. And that was the second wreck that
week.
They say
that there's not an issue, and you're saying you'll get them out.
I'm going to get them, yes.
I mean, can you email somebody or email the, let us
well,
email
I can stay. I can stay in. It seems like Greg's got the most powerful email going.
Okay.
Next to me, but I can't. I can use my email for updates, if you will. I don't want to get too weird in there, but I can absolutely give the community some updates and things. But for this, because y'all are so involved right here, and y'all apparently care the most of anybody because you're here tonight. But I'll definitely get in touch with Greg and let him know, or tell him they need to at least call you, let you know what's going on out there.
And another question, that where they're building that, I talked to Mr. Campmore today. That the pond back there that waters the shrubbery is fed by underground stream, and the lake below there is fed by underground stream.
Okay, so let's say we approve their sketch plat for something that's already zoned. After that, it goes to the next stages through engineering. I can go to engineering and I can tell them all these things.
Okay.
And to keep a double eye out for it, and they will. They absolutely will. And when there's waters on the ground or springs or creeks, it doesn't matter what they ask for in a mile of lots. They can't encroach on those with those lots or houses. They have to stay off of them with the actual structures themselves a certain feet. They may not get 25 or 23 if there's as much water in there as you say there is. It will absolutely shrink it down from what we zone. There's a lot of times they get what they want, a lot of times they don't. When the truth comes down to it.
Can I just throw that kind of chain going back to the original subject? Just trying to give a point of clarity or maybe one focus with the stop sign, the Windy Hill, the road grading. We have the same amount of control over getting Ryland to grade the hill as we do getting the county to put in a stop sign. Let's say they agree with grading the road down, great, fine, and dandy, but you still got cars going real fast. Now they're going to go faster because they can see
farther.
So would a better solution not be, since we have no control over it, to unanimously shoot for a stop sign? Because that would make getting out a lot easier, right? And it'd be tremendously less expensive.
I've got it on my notes.
Not taking down that hill because of the water shedding and give Ryland opportunity to use that channel instead of going across Mullinax to come down to the same creek that washed out his driveway.
Right. So, so all stop the way sign only
the entire
is better?
Windy Hill Court community.
Yes. Because the hill holds water, and if they had to stop,
the hill keeps the water from going down into people's front yards. It flows back toward Mullinax versus coming down.
So,
I mean, that's not.
It benefits you, and then we could maybe go back to looking at larger lots.
But we'll go hand in hand with you to the county.
Yeah, but does Ryland? Three stop signs, a three-way stop sign is a whole lot less money than cutting down that hill. Don't you think you guys would be interested in trying to get the commissioners to approve that?
And the stop sign
we
thing.
We know. That's what I'm trying to tell you all. Right. We don't have the authority.
Or whoever it
that.
Takes to
it's
to
the engineering department with their engineering traffic degree. They're supposed to be able to use certain criteria for justifications for things like this. I don't have that degree in engineering. So if I did that, next thing I know, I'd put something up. The criteria might not match, and I'm getting sued. So.
No.
Mr. Scott, the principle that these folks are asking for, if I can help summarize it perhaps, is what I've often wondered when I look at the way that Ryland does business. It's the cheapest product possible, get in, get out. And I understand that from a business perspective because of the every builder I know is afraid of a double dip recession. So you guys want, it's turn and burn, but just like the neighborhood that's right behind Covenant School here. The principle that seems to get lost in these conversations is if you can make $50,000 on 100 homes, or you make $100,000 on 50 homes, it's the same amount of money. And what the market has shown up and down Post Road is that the market will pay money for a premium product. Why will Ryland, in all of their developments in this county, refuse to build a premium product?
I don't think that it's that they've refused to build a premium product. I think that Ryland, and I can't speak for their marketing, I'm just their attorney with respect to land use, but I think that they're always shooting for a product mix. I mean, for instance, in Madison and in Bridleton down on Old Atlanta Road, which isn't coming out of the ground yet, their houses are over $500,000.
In Madison?
I'm not talking about Madison specifically. I'm talking about down on Bridleton. But the ones in Madison are probably more expensive than the ones in Post Preserve, I would imagine. So it's my understanding from them, they usually try to shoot for a product mix. Their goal, I would imagine, is to sell the houses for as much as possible because they make more money that way. But as far as the market factors go, I understand what you're saying. I mean, it seems to make sense to me, but what I'm being told by the builders, not just Ryland, you know, is that they try to target specific markets and price points, and I mean, that's...
Well, they're probably also wanting to build this one, and they want to sell it in the high twos, low threes, because then they're going to sell out probably before they're done. The neighborhood's going to be done in a year, assuming they get approval. It'll be done and sold, and they'll take their profits and dump them into the next 10 products. That's probably what they're doing, is they're looking for some seed money that they know they can get. Well, that's not in the best interest of the community.
Well, they're also trying to make sure that they don't find themselves in a situation with lots of inventory that they can't move because they price too high. And we've seen similar things at other developments, not from Ryland, but I have more experience with, like, Wheeland. And we've seen similar things. They priced themselves at a point where they thought the market was, when in fact, you could look at, you know, sales for the previous 6 months and clearly see that the price point was much higher. But they don't want the inventory, because as soon as they have inventory sitting there, then if something happens with the economy, they're stuck and out of money.
And they start losing money.
Exactly.
Every
so
day
they,
that they
they're pricing there. Themselves to a point where they can move quickly and get out, unfortunately.
Well true, but I think anybody that's looked at what's selling in the
county. Well, I don't disagree with you. I think they've priced themselves way too low.
Yeah.
But they.
And I get that concept. You wouldn't want to build a $600,000 house on a 9,000 square foot lot up here. It's not going to work. But you could certainly add $100,000 to your targeted selling price by adding 500 square feet to the minimum size.
I think your products nowadays, obviously a ranch over a two-story, by the time you add all your fees and your interest carrying, your real estate commissions and the lot cost in the building, most two-story houses, depending on the finish obviously, are going to be around 100 to 120.
And the ranches are probably more in the range of around 115 to about 135, just because you have a bigger foundation and bigger roof on it. So when you, if you do a 3,000 square foot house, if it's 110, you'll be around 330. But I agree with you totally. If they eliminated 10% of lots, just made them all a little bit bigger, mm-hmm. that would absolutely wash back through a more expensive home.
I think the bigger picture too, what I would ask you to carry back to Ryland is they're clearly very happy in our county, as seen by what they've already done and what they're planning to do. If we can find that happy medium where they can say we're not going to be the low rent section of Forsyth County, we would rather be a little more exclusive, 400,000 or 500,000 more. If we can find that agreement and all come to some midpoint, we'll make the commissioners' lives and Ryland's lives a lot easier.
Yeah. All we need is a few stop signs.
Can they put in the, I mean, is this a situation where if the engineering group agreed, could Ryland put the stop signs in?
If I could get them to agree, that the county could put stop signs in. It's not a big expense. No. Obviously, we have some money for emergency funds for emergency situations. I got some money approved for a stacking lane at the middle school. You ever seen what those moms and dads and the children in the cars have hanging off the road and cars whizzing by them? Well, once they get the culvert fixed from the washout, there's going to be a 900-foot stacking lane there to get those cars out of your way. Once again, state schools, state road, county money. But it's to serve our citizens still. So, but there is some. There's no problem. Top signs are easy. If I just get them to agree, if it's a criteria and they don't tell me there's some kind of legal reason for liability why they can't.
Why you got him in the car in the morning? Try pulling out.
No, I'm getting out of the car first. I promise you that. What y'all are saying.
Good question.
Yes, ma'am.
Several years ago, they put a stop sign at the corner of Mullinax and Corn Trail.
Yeah.
That's what they're just telling me.
And mystically, magically, and wonderfully delicious, it was taken away. Now, we live right there at the corner of that intersection. And that is a death trap.
Thanks to Michael.
And I almost got rear-ended 5 days ago.
I'll ask you about that as well.
But stop signs are great and wonderful. But somehow, wonderfully, they just magically disappear.
So even if they're put
Michael
in.
Michael Bennett.
We were basically told by Commissioner Bennett when he was in, the convenience to the polo fields was more important than having the stop sign.
For the safety of the people who lived on Camorra Trail.
Stop sign on Mullinax?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
It was three.
Yeah.
We
put that back.
Potentially,
we
got it put in.
And the county.
Yeah, that was
more or less backing
took
up.
Took it out and raised the speed limit. So you animal I had was killed in the next month.
If they go through with the widening of Mullinax with the medium lane, is it still going to be where if you leave Camorra on the Mullinax, you can turn left or right?
I can't tell you that. I get the question.
The initial plan showed that. Capabilities of doing that. I'm told now that it's not going to be that way.
And
that's going to be hard on an old man like me.
They're not going to let you turn left.
You could go back to Ryland and tell them we're going to move backwards to work with them. We've taken out the idea of cutting down the hill. And
last.
I'm sorry?
They won't stop sign first. We go up for water control.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, with the guarantee that the stop sign stays in place.
Yeah.
And not to put up for the development and taken down.
Yeah.
Exactly. Let me ask this. Can the hill come down some and still...
How about do both?
Doesn't have to come down 10 feet.
No, right, but could it come down some to get a little bit of sight distance?
Yes, because I'm afraid someone's going to top that hill.
Can they
build fewer homes and just make our hill a little shorter?
But that's why they put a sign back up there. Stop sign.
But you know
people don't.
They are green signs that don't look like they should sometimes.
How much traffic goes down?
They put it down 5 foot. That's big.
Do you know how much traffic goes down Mullinax? Does anybody have that information?
No.
Let's try to have one at a time. We're going to lose everybody.
Just the one thing that I would mention, I totally agree with the safety comments that have been said. But if there's 12,000 cars going down Mullinax and hitting a three-way stop sign,
anybody flowing through there is going to find a nightmare. Mm-hmm. So I think it's clear that, especially if you guys band together and want a solution, I wouldn't put all your hopes on a stop sign, because more than likely the engineering is going to come back and say, traffic's going to come to a standstill no matter what direction you're going.
But traffic's already at a standstill.
I agree. So I think that you know, consider other alternative stop signs might be what look like the best solution, but in fact, it may turn out that's really just creating a bigger problem elsewhere. It might solve the safety issue, but there's other ways you can do that too.
Just for clarification, you're talking about a different stop sign. Stop sign on Windy Hill is a much lower traffic.
Yeah. It's not on that stop sign.
That's what I was trying to find out, was where that traffic.
Yeah, no, this one's off Windy Hill that cut through back to France.
Let's just do one more, and I'm going to recap, make sure I got my notes right.
When you get John out with you, can you guys stop at the creek and address our pothole where our bridge is beginning to sink in on the road as well?
Which is that?
The one on Mullinax Road, right before you get to Windy Hill Drive.
If
you were coming back this way on Mullinax, it's already doing just like it's doing on Post Road.
Yeah.
On Post Road. And then I have one more. I know you said one more and you was going to recap, but one of the things we have not touched on, and we touched on it in the commissioner's meeting, is what has been the scenario on the sewer after the county said you may not go under Mullinax Road? Josh, can you address that, what Ryland is proposing to do with
that?
We
have not heard back. Tim Perkins, I think, was looking into it. It's not so much crossing under Mullinax as it is running parallel to the right-of-way. Our first option is to go on the county's right-of-way and not go through anybody's property. I mean, we don't want to do that.
We leave that up to the water sewer director to make those calls. Mm. He knows his system better than anybody else and what works and what doesn't. He just has to make sure his system works and whatever they do doesn't cause a failure.
Because you can get a sewer there in several different ways. But I think that it's been done for a long time. I think this is sort of a new. You can go on the other side of Mullinax, you can go back to the creek, you can go through the industrial park. I mean, there's sewer everywhere over there.
Sure.
So when will we know what's going to happen? I mean, we can sit up here and talk all night long.
Well, that's on the recap, if you don't mind.
Okay.
But thank you for that. So I'm hoping Mr. Scoggins goes back to Ryland and asks them for 10,000, 11,000, 12,000 square foot lots. If they could reevaluate their business plan and make a bigger home on a bigger lot.
And not have to take out the hill.
And not have to take out the hill. Or some of the hill, maybe not as much of the hill, but that's all. But hold on.
John is saying in his email that if there was ever a three-way stop sign placed there, a portion of the hill would have to be removed.
But that's right, because I was saying they have to have sight distance to the stop sign. So all of this is going to be, as I was going to say, this will be decided by the engineering department, because I can't do that.
To see the stop sign, but not to see the cars.
No, you have to have it for both, okay?
I know.
I want to give them all the above. So recapping that, we're going to bring them out and let them assess it. I'm going to share all of the sentiments here and what y'all want. But if at all possible, try to maintain the water going the direction it is and don't change that. Because that's going to be hardship on some other folks that sounds like.
Right.
And at what point the balance comes in where the engineering department says it meets the criteria of safety, whenever you make an improvement, you've got to make that improvement to the standards, because I know that exists, it just does. And I can't tell you exactly what those are, I leave that up to them. And by the way, let's do this one again. We hope they'll increase the lot sizes and the house sizes.
That's the building.
And certainly, here's how a lot of this, if you will, by the way, back to your point, typically when they, not always, but typically when they figured their business plan, at least old school was this way, your lot cost is about 1/5 of the overall house price. So to your point, yes, it does make sense that if you make the lot a little bit bigger and it becomes a little bit more expensive, you don't have as many, you build a bigger house, you charge a little more, the formula still works.
You're still going to sell it.
Still can work. Is it their? But is it their business plan? I don't know. I mean, I can't get into that part. It's not my legal right to do that. But we can certainly say we want bigger lots If you want us to be your friend, you need to be ours too. Please do bigger lots and do bigger houses.
And not just on this, but
That's correct.
Ryland wants to build a relationship with the community.
Absolutely.
On other zoning things, we'll remember.
That's correct. Don't ruin our community and then leave us.
Right.
And exactly. County, I would say that doing that is going to mitigate or going to help us with the traffic, quality of life, the whole deal. I mean, it's a win-win.
Yeah.
They got to change out. They got to reassess. You got to work the numbers, work the lots. But bigger houses, fewer cars.
It helps our tax digest as well, to where the commissioners don't ever have to raise the millage rate.
Right.
And there is a magic number in there, depending on the services you use, whether it's 250 or 350 is really the argument, depending on the service you use. But if you can keep all those houses 350 to 500, it makes it so much easier just to balance budgets. It just does.
I think it's important to repeat what you just said, which essentially what you're saying is a $280,000 house is a losing cash flow problem.
Or barely break even, and if it happens to be a house that's dialing 911 all the time, it's a losing proposition. Right. However, you balance out the ones that do and don't, because some of us have horses perhaps, but you have to dial 911, and sometimes in your lifetime you don't. Hopefully nobody here has to.
So this gets to the broader picture countywide, and I'll take 2 minutes. I know this is specific to this area, but I'm nervous about the stop sign because I think regardless of the stop sign, this entire road out here is going to be a dead stop 24 hours a day. We've got 1,000 homes going in up here on Post Road from, like you said, lots that were
way back,
that were zoned well before this current commission. However, there's a Res 4 just north of the subject property we're talking about tonight that you will vote on. It's a 6,000 square foot minimum lot size, so it's less than 1/7 of an acre. With 2,000 square foot homes, they're asking for variances to put the homes 11 feet apart. And this law firm is representing them. I know that it may not be Josh's client.
Tell him what I told you today, what happened in that meeting.
That issue's off the table.
Well, we got to look at it. There's no way I'm going for that.
Yeah, and you can go, you cannot go for it all you want, but you've got to get two other votes.
I got to get three to lean my way. You're exactly correct.
So to the folks in this room.
I always will get, and this is why sometimes, whether you agree or disagree with another commissioner, try to have a cordial relationship because you're still going to need them to work with you on other things. You have to, it's just the way it is. So hopefully, you're right. I have asked them not to go over 2.1, 2.2. Let's bring it down. Let's get the lots bigger.
And no blanket variances.
No, that was my words yesterday. They need to be a hardship of some sort. It doesn't have to be a massive hardship. But show me individually why each lot needs to be that, not a blanket of a neighborhood, was my words yesterday in the meeting. Anyways, with them, they were trying to make the point that we back up to CBD, we back up to Res 6. Why can't we be? I said, well, let's see, because you touch Ag 1, there's agriculture across the road, and you touch a 2.1 right next to it. So, you know, and they said, well, if we go back down to Res 3, we can go as high as 2.5. I said, you sure can. And right now, we can go as low as 1 per acre. So what's the average? So this is just how you, I mean, they're going to pull you as hard as they can. It's big dollars for them. But you know where my mindset is. Yeah,
absolutely.
I got one more question. Since this was, you know, back in 2006, whatever, it was voted this and that, what are y'all doing to some of these old properties and everything that was back in 2006? Are y'all changing?
You can't. If it's zoned, it's zoned. We don't have any authority to touch unless that landowner petitions for it and files for a change of some sort. Only at that time are we allowed to get involved in changing anything.
So even though the county grows leaps and bounds, traffic out of control.
You can't. It's nuts, isn't it? And there's so many zoned right now. Look, this is one reason why I ran for commissioner. Just one of the many, but that in the budget was drastically, the general fund was drastically low, which is now back up again. But that's exactly it. Are y'all familiar with the Venable property?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
That was a big, don't make it so heavy density, two-lane roads, it can't handle it. I saw some comments that there's going to be 2.5 times the traffic of what the, they changed the name of the shopping center and just got bought out recently. The Collections. What that causes, and it was there, Castleberry Road, Highway 9, and Majors Road. Thank God somebody came in more recently that wanted to buy that and actually zone it. They petitioned
for some different product density and such. They were kind enough to really sit down with me for months and months and months, because we all should go back to the state for their approval as well. The one, over 1 million square feet of commercial that was zoned is now 182. Dropped by 82%. Not all by me, but sure begging by me, and they were very accommodating. They made it a beautiful village living now there for the stores. The houses that were about 900 are now a little bit less than 500. So that's how it can change, but they have to come forward with it. And then you could do more conditions.
So
and by the way, those products are going to be quite amazing products.
Yeah. So if the people are nice enough and everything,
if they,
got a conscience, they would come forward.
Or if they have a different business plan that they understand what this gentleman's been saying over here. Because the 1/5 rule works. You got to figure out your bigger lots, the numbers, and the price range.
Exactly.
You know, how fast that product will sell that, and their interest carry. They got to do all that. I can't get into that. But I understand it enough to agree with the gentleman.
So can we talk tactics for a second?
Sure.
You're committed to supporting.
Can she ask a question first?
Absolutely.
Hey, Greg, hang on a sec.
Yes, ma'am, I'm so sorry.
I've been trying to jump on down, but I was
just about to climb up on the table here. I believe I represent all of the livestock owners in the area that are scared of getting squeezed out by all of the people coming in from the city, thinking they want to live in this in the country, and then deciding they don't like our horses, our cows, and our chickens, and whatever else people have. I think there's some llamas down the road somewhere. I want a guarantee that it's going to be in the covenants, in the contracts, that these people can't move into our agricultural area and complain about what we have.
They could do things like that, that state, and I've seen them put it in there. When they sign for those covenants, it's in there that says, I understand that this property is surrounded by livestock, and I accept
this. This is what happened when Shepherd's Pond was built. It was put into the covenants that they couldn't complain about the business going on at Kennymore Nursery. And the first thing these people did was come in and complain because they were parking trucks there. Well, they didn't have a leg to stand on because it was in the contracts, in the covenants, that they could not complain. And I need to be protected here.
That's an excellent.
Absolutely. And you could always build a big chicken house, couldn't you?
We have a big chicken house. We just have horses.
Well, you could always put some chickens in it right about the time they go to break ground.
Well, if they give me trouble, they can always put chickens in it. We got plenty of room for a hog farm.
Right.
Put one over there on Windy Hill Drive. They won't stand the smell.
The neighbors that I've had for 30 years, I've been there 30 years. I think if you ask the neighbors, they'll tell you I'm a pretty good guy. I'm all right. I mean, you know,
yeah, but don't get riled.
It's not the prettiest barn in the country. It's the old Mullinax chicken barn.
Yeah. I think it's
historic. It's historic.
Don't go there. It's not that historical. Not so historical it can't be torn down someday.
Not like that,
but nice.
So we're going to get the bigger lots, Todd. We're going to ask for the bigger lots and the covenant she's asking for.
All right. So let me touch back on the rest of this stuff. And by the way, I'll give you an update on the summit on the 30th too. Hopefully, we've got some leverage there too. And by the way, believe it or not, this whole thing that Greg has created with the traffic and his website and getting people riled up, although some people are blaming me because they don't really know about the zonings, ultimately it's helping. Got a phone, as I answered about 500 emails myself, I asked them to contact their state representatives and help me. I can't do it all. I can't. They don't just listen to me because I'm one vote. If they think you all go vote against them, they wake up. 3 days ago, I got a call from Senator Murphy. Commissioner Levent, you planning on running against me? I said, what you doing about Highway 9, Senator? So it's kind of a fun conversation, but he understands we're serious. He gets it now. He's seen all of these emails, and I'm hoping that getting this going now, or summit on the 30th, and they're going into session the first of the year, I really hope he's able to find some money out of that budget. and get it up here and get this started. Because even if they do now, it's still 5 years, 6 years. They got to get started. That's what he told me. I said, I don't care. You got to start to get it done. Mm-hmm. So he feels the pressure, which is a very good thing. Thank you, Greg, that this is getting going. It really is.
Can I add one thing to that, Commissioner?
Sure.
For us to win any of these battles, we need three votes. We have two pretty good votes, traditionally, Commissioner Levent and Commissioner Boff. I think that it's relatively impossible that we're going to get the two northern commissioners to go along. So the swing vote in all this is Commissioner Tam, who has higher political aspirations from what we hear. Senator Murphy may need to call him and ask him if he plans on running for his seat, because that's what we hear his plan is. So I think more than hammering Commissioner Levent, which we've done, I think we need to turn our gaze onto Commissioner Brian Tam and let him know that if he were ever to run for an office that we get to vote for, because we can't vote for him. He's not in our district anymore.
But you have friends over there in his district.
We have friends in his district, and if he ever wants to run for state senator, if he wants to run for anything like that, we will remember these votes on these specific issues. And when he talks about us having their attention, I think Brian Tam is very closely watching what we're doing and is aware of these issues and needs to know how to vote.
Perhaps on your website you could make another suggestion, as you did for emailing the Board of Commissioners, about the points that should be made to our state representatives and to Tam, and the email addresses, and maybe we can put up sample letters so it's very easy for people to do a cut and paste or whatever is necessary.
I'll share one more. I know Ms. Tisdale's got this camera, and it's going to cause me all kinds of political grief for those people getting more things done, but it's the way it is. Mark Hamilton, House Representative Mark Hamilton and Jack Murphy are very senior people. They've both been there for 12 years. Mark Hamilton is on the DOT committee board. I think he chairs it, matter of fact. He lives in the Polo Fields. I asked him about Post Road, and he told me I never drive it, Commissioner. Come on. No, I don't. Sure, he drives it. But he was trying to ignore the situation. Your emails will bring light to it. Be sincere, be respectful, but be a matter of fact, just like you are with me.
How about getting the attention? What's your advice on getting the attention of county employees like the director of engineering?
I have to sit down with the county manager, because that's how the chain of command goes. And then the assistant county manager, those two I can go to at any time. And the chain of command from there is they have to go to the employees and they deal with them. I am not allowed to politically go to them directly.
We're just,
and get
I'm
them
trying to figure
commands.
Out for these people, like when the driveway washes out and nobody will answer, what's his next option?
Well,
to call the county manager?
Here's the interesting part. When we get emails and to our county site, and they will go to the county manager and commissioners, you can get on that link and hit all of us. You'll be surprised at how the county manager, deputy county manager get involved. And we don't typically have to say a word to them. Or we can say, can you give me an update on that situation?
So they
follow through with it to give me an update.
Okay. Can you, so we can't require, you can't require, because they're a county employee, a traffic study?
For this issue
that they've been talking about?
We're going to have a lot of conversations in the car with whoever, whether it's the county manager, deputy county manager, for a lot of these conversations. Okay. I think we got it. Unless there's anything else anybody else wants to touch on, I've got my notes.
Could you clarify on the sewage easement issue, too, for the gentleman that was asking somehow whether... because you said you haven't gotten an update on whether you're going to need a sewer easement from surrounding property owners, and there is a condition.
And it may or may not. The county director, he told me that he may work something out with that.
Okay.
With all the widening of the road and all, there's some other things. You know, there's a lot of planning there that goes with this coming up. And it seems like it may come up faster than it was all this.
Okay.
Will we still have the November the 7th public meeting?
There won't be any chance to speak at a public hearing for that one item. People can actually speak at the first of the meeting. I think it's a 30-minute window for people doing that public speaking if you wish to. Yeah, at the very first of the meeting, not the first of that agenda item. But I really, really hope that everybody comes up with what they want and everybody's happy. It gets me not being pulled so tough. And ultimately, that's what I want. I mean, honestly, everybody likes to have the conditions they like, not their lives disrupted. They like to keep the quality of life that they're used to. And they're going to follow the state constitution and whatever it allow them to do for zoning. That's just what they do for a living. And I get used to that, and it's just part of it. But I know I've got to try to cater and get y'all whatever I can.
Well, it's to their benefit, too, because they want a long-term relationship
yes,
in
ma'am.
This community. Mm-hmm. We, you know, this kind of sets a tone for how we'll respond
yes,
to what comes down the road.
I agree. Yeah.
Because we can also come to the public hearings and speak against other Ryland developments, even
right.
though we don't live
yeah,
in
yeah, we can't
area.
Just pay attention to our specific area. Actually, I had planned on for everybody here, as time permits, to start watching a few more of the zoning applications in our area and emailing and letting people know when they're coming up before the board so that we don't have situations like we had at the last meeting where several zoning applications came through and just sailed by because nobody spoke up except for with ours.
And I'm going to tell you, any time these come up and somebody gets organized and there's three or four to represent, I'm open. We can meet, well, I meet with Post Road Group. I meet with different groups all the time in their area, and I meet with HOA presidents or the HOA board or the people in the neighborhood all the time. It's very acceptable to call me. And once, and it's easier that way to have the conditions set in place that everybody's looking for, and everybody will be on board in writing up on there without trying to add something to the last minute that might get messed up.
Yeah.
It's so much easier. So don't, y'all, my number, is available. It's real simple. Actually, my email is too, but if you want my county cell phone number, I'll give it to you right now. It's real simple. 678-386-5167. I just gave it to Nydia to put on YouTube for the world to know. No telling who's going to call now.
I'd like to find out what the buffer is and that being increased.
Well, I think they did an increased buffer. Am I mistaken or not?
No, we've agreed to the 25-foot exterior with the 50-foot setback. I have not revised the conditions yet, but if Beth has your email, she's sort of been my de facto contact
person. What's the
buffer
from the other properties?
There is a 25-foot buffer from our property line in, and then a 50-foot building setback, which prevents any structures from being within 50 feet. That's not required on a development of this size, but we're
it's not
putting it on there. I don't know what the buffer you or anyone else may have on your property. Probably none, I would imagine.
Right.
Given the,
I'd like to see if they entertain the idea of a 50-foot buffer on your side.
I can certainly talk to them about it.
But keep in mind, if you do that, you can't increase the size of the house. You just squeeze them. I mean, you keep.
Or they said less houses.
Well, right.
You know that, I mean, that would push it in forward.
But though. You got to decide you want the bigger lot, the bigger house. I mean, you got to really see what meets the most to you. You know, you make the buffer, can they fit the bigger house in anymore? I know that we don't want the lot. But let's say you increase a lot and you increase the buffer, there's no room for the house again.
Well, but one of the things with the trees that he keeps bringing up, okay,
trees?
As an example to where our lot joins to where Ryland is going to go.
Yes.
Got an elevation coming off of that terraced hill of 1040.
Yes.
Coming back into my lot at 1010. Ryland's telling me there will be no runoff. Well, that's 30 feet difference. Where's the water going?
Yeah.
See, and if you take all them trees out, because I fought with the county when the industrial park was built up there, we had to go back to the county, get them to put their silt fence up, get them to put the hay bales up, right? Because it was washing my backyard out. And my driveway washes out from the industrial park all the way down. We put gravel. We have
what industrial park is that?
Grasslands.
And do you know about which property address just back up to you that's probably dumping on you?
No, but I can find out and I can call you.
Just look, when I hear this, I got a piece of property myself over here, and I've got a light industrial park behind me, and God only knows how or why they let them. But they literally drain into a drain that dumps right at my line. You're not allowed to do that. So I'm just curious.
We can put gravel, because then I have a paved driveway. I have a gravel driveway about 650 feet up. And I can put a load of gravel on there, and it comes a heavy rain, and the drainage washes my gravel into Windy Hill Drive. Done.
And all the water runs right back.
So you don't know the address?
I'll find out, and I can give you a call.
Yeah, that's great. Now y'all have my number, right? I mean, look, I'm always available.
25-foot buffer, the
part from the line to our driveway. And that just wasn't enough to hold back some of that water.
Yeah, it should have probably been more of a 50. Was it about 40 on commercial?
40-foot buffer, 50-foot setback now. But that park is so old.
That's what happens with some of that, unfortunately.
Well, we plan on being there till we're old and don't want a new problem.
The buffer, the buffers always increase as the code becomes more onerous. But a lot, you know, a lot of developments, some of them may not have any buffers on them. If it was built back in the 80s or 70s.
I was going to point out, just kind of going back to a more like a high level, what I think we as a community are looking for out of Ryland. But also wanted to point out, I know you're going to take this back to Ryland, but there's a very strong likelihood that any other developer comes here is going to give your law firm a call.
Hopefully.
To represent. Right. So if you could share that with anybody looking looking here, we're looking to be a little bit more exclusive and not to have such a low price point. It's mm-hmm. You got the front entry garages that people always fill up their garages with other stuff, so the cars are always on the street or in the drive. It's just not it's not what we're looking for here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Todd, do you have any idea what they're soil testing and getting ready to survey and construct or do on out Windy Hill Drive? They're soil testing there right before you get to the creek and the small lake. They're surveying and already got heavy equipment going off of Windy Hill Drive back into the industrial park on a corner lot that's been vacant. Do you have any idea what that might be
this
zoned
development?
For?
Yeah.
Yes, Windy Hill Drive. No, not joining Ryland. I'm saying on down Windy Hill Drive, there's soil testing. Which is what they did 3 months ago before you bought it.
Windy Hill Drive, Francis
I looked it up, and it's an 85,000 square foot warehouse with parking.
85,000 square foot warehouse with parking.
That's a lot of water shedding.
That's some big time water shed again, right back into that creek that keeps washing this gentleman's driveway out.
Yeah, and to say it washed out his driveway, that's putting it mildly. This guy had a 15 foot gap, 10 feet deep in the middle of the driveway.
Couldn't get
when they say it washed out, it doesn't do it justice.
You know, if I have the engineer director of the car, obviously this is something to go. And I need to get them out at your address. I don't want to give the address over the whole camera, over the whole world to hear your address. You'll write it down so I can stop by there.
While he's doing that, if anybody didn't have an email address, if you have a phone number, I'll call instead to let you know what we find out from Josh.
Prudent, responsible zoning would avoid a lot of the things y'all talked about tonight.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. The water comes from Dr. Dan Marks. There's a lake up there. It all comes back to him. All that water from Walmart, it comes back to him.
And to Kroger.
And Kroger, it comes back to him. Yeah. And where they're building that industrial, what they just talking about, it comes back to him. It all comes to him.
He's at the very end of the street in the cul-de-sac. And right at the creek.
And I went back in there and just see what's going on in that rain we had here last night.
Is there a pipe that goes under driveway that
just oh, it just washed it completely.
Well, I've been living there for like 36 years.
Yeah.
And for years and years, it was fine.
Mr.
And then everybody started dumping into the rain.
That's what you're talking about. This is what I'm talking about, houses being 20 feet apart minimum because the impervious. The soils can't absorb it when you start building too many rooftops.
Exactly. All the water, when you start paving, knocking trees down and everything, all the water's going to go somewhere.
But then everybody says they can't help it.
All right.
And you're left with no driveway, no way in your house.
That's not good. All right, we'll be out there tomorrow or the next day, I promise you. We'll spend some time out there.
Thank you
all for coming and giving me a chance to speak to y'all.
Thank you very much. Remember those days?
Okay. Yeah. I'm like the fifth house that left on Harris Springs.
Okay.
So, you know where Coleman Square is? I'm right next to Coleman
Square. Oh, okay. Yeah.
So you are
George?
So if I reach out and ask, you can help me get another one. I'll hire one, appreciate it.
We're going to do another run. I think that one thing we contemplate doing, there's something that the post office does.
Yeah, these range board heads. I mean, of course, we're literally can't really have plans here.
You get a bunch of cars and drafts.
With the range of bad, I'll watch about rooms.
Oh, yeah.